very, very much, and I'm delighted that you came to the Hungry Eye tonight. Because it takes a lot of courage to come into a joint that's this filthy. Let me give you one word of warning. Don't ever eat here. I ordered a steak rare. You ready? With a little care, this thing could have recovered. But I drank it. But we still have a lot of fun in here every night. One woman nearly died laughing. But I'm all right now. Of course, I realize that all the women in the audience have absolutely got to wonder why I am dressed like this. There's no excuse. But there are a lot of reasons. And mostly they involve bad luck. One thing I want to explain, these knobs here in front, you could twist these all night and the picture doesn't get any better. I'm a fool for new products, and I try them all, and that's when I get in trouble. Man, Tan, I tried that. I had to give it up. It lowered my voice. And I'll tell you what really did it. The day my husband called home and said, "Is that you, Sam?" Sam had been gone for hours. And then this cigarette, I tried this brand, and I will never smoke another. I carry them for people I hate. You wouldn't believe it. The claim sounded so great. They claimed that nobody could get any type of lung irritation because of this powerful filter. But what they didn't tell is that you can get a dreadful hernia from the draw. Explain about the gown because the girls must know that this is the Jackie look. Gleason. I bought the dress and I never knew what was wrong with it till I got it home, went out in the backyard to hang up the wash. Are you ready? You think my legs are bad, you ought to see my body. We haven't had that many people in the backyard since the doghouse burned. Of course, I should never have left him have the matches. But he said he was going to burn a cat, and we believed him. Neurotic dog. I hated him. He was so dumb. You can't find a dog that dumb. But we looked. And this, I want to tell you about this. Got to tell you about this. I made in bead craft. It was therapy. And it didn't come any place near my problem. But I'll tell you what it does. My cultural work just keeps me so sane and from flipping and all those good things. Because, see, I can really honestly say that I am a highbrow. Oh, hell yes. I have went to the best schools. In fact, I was very big at Wasserman. I was pregnant. The only girl graduated magna cum baby. See, I'm from such an old family, it's been condemned. Oh, I am descended from a very long line my mother once foolishly listened to. And I belong to the Bookie of the Month Club. Oh, and this month I just got the book. It's called Getting Along with People by Maria Callas. With a foreword by Oscar Levan. Oh, boy, oh, boy. They're hypochondriacs, you know. A hypochondriac really enjoys smelling of Vicks. I bet every one of you knows a person that you do not dare ask, how are you? Because if they don't have a disease, they know where they can get it. We had a guy in our group that he got so bad he was having his x-rays enlarged. And if he liked them, he had them tinted. And he was having them made so big, his kidney was a pool. And there were people in it. And one guy was doing a backstroke and it was hurting. So we decided we would cure him by teasing him out of this junk. So we all bugged him and teased him and teased him and bugged him. And you know what he did? He died. Oh, we were so embarrassed. But I'll tell you who I blame for that whole trend, the Reader's Digest. They write too much about that stuff, and I'm going to be very frank with you. I don't give a hoot where my liver bile duct empties. I'll be concerned the day it starts emptying into my pocket. But I still won't go to a doctor. I'll go to my dressmaker. I'll tell her, sweetie, either dry it up or button it. That'll make her spit the pins out. See, I'm an authoress, too. Now, my third book at this very moment is going into its sixth printing. Of course, if I could print better, I wouldn't have to do it over. And the name of my book is Passion, Power, Greed, and Fury. It's a cookbook. Which I have already been requested to rewrite by the food and drug people. Boy, what a bunch of narrow-minded busybodies they are. They paid me a visit in my little spotless kitchen. The dog had died. Well, actually, he committed suicide. He begged from the table, and by George, we fed him. I even remember what did it. I had developed the most divine sauce for burnt food. And it tasted exactly like ungantini. Because it was ungantini. And it's great for people. It cures heartburn. But it kills dogs. He just went belched and went blah. He didn't even bark goodbye. And the first thing the food and drug people did for my kitchen was to declare it a disaster area. Just because it was on fire. Nothing but a little grease fire. You know, women have them in the stove all the time. Mine was in the sink. Oh, I got a greasy sink. I have watched bugs slide to their death. And you know, when the food and drug people arrived, and unannounced, if I could have just been combing my hair or reading a book or anything, but I was cooking. I was making a pudding and I knew something was wrong with it. Couldn't get the spoon out. And they tried to stir it and the whole room went around. Well, that fanned the hell out of the fire. They're the ones that turned it into a real hook and ladder party. And then they got terribly interested in my pudding and they wanted to take it to their lab to test it. Well, they had to. One of their guys was now stuck in it. So they took it to the lab and tested it. Are you ready? My pudding is bulletproof. I never expected my recipes to put this book over. It was my household hints that I was counting on because I'm very good at that. I'll give you an example. Supposing you are a housewife and you have goofed. Well, let's put it this way. It's 4:30 and you're still in bed. And you know, that's getting pretty close to ogre time. And when the beast comes home, the beauty better be ready. So here's the way you play that. You put a little O-cedar wax behind each ear. It makes you smell tired. It works, and I had developed something to do with leftover sauerkraut. So you can only do it during December, though. Silver it and hang it on the tree. It stinks, but it's beautiful. I consider this creative homemaking. When things happen and you take care... Well, all right, our stove broke down one day. I mean, way down. Well, to the basement. Well, there was something heavy in it. A cupcake. So I tell you what I did. I heated his dinner in the dryer. And I admit it was a mess. But it was hot. So I realized that I would have to treat him rather graciously, which was going to be pretty unnatural at that time of day. So I read a couple of chapters of Peyton Place and a little Norman Vincent Peale. I even put on a dress over my blue jeans. And when I say I kissed him, he thought he was in the wrong house. Until one of the kids bit him. The way we know they're growing up, the bite marks are higher. So I brought him in the house, I sat him down, I put this food in front of him, and right away he starts with the beef. He says, okay, what is this stuff on top? You know I hate coconut. I said, eat it, it's lint. He had given up lint for Lent. But you know, when I get around food, I get into trouble, even when I shop for it. Is that ridiculous? I bought a piece of Romano cheese, and this guy at the delicatessen says, lady, because that was a bad guess. I know what threw him off. I was wearing chiffon. I had been bowling. And he says, lady, the longer you keep this kind of cheese, the better it gets. Then he kissed it. You know, I began to wonder how long he'd had it. I know it's dull work, but how lonely can it get? I felt that he was an authority, so I bought it 4 years ago. Well, the man lied. Someplace along the line, we have passed better. I can't cut it, I can't catch it. But every now and then, I open the refrigerator door and throw it some food. It's getting crosser and meaner. And next year it has to have a license. Scared to death of it. And think of the extra work. That thing has to be aired. The dogs won't run with it. I don't blame them. It's so ugly. It's got this penicillin fur all over. And one lousy leg. And that isn't even in the middle. I take it out, it doesn't know what to chase. I'm the only woman on the block that walks a piece of cheese. Oh, and then Thanksgiving. Worst news. I stuffed the turkey. And that's the last. It took me 3 weeks. Stuffed it through the beak. It was the only thing open. And I was very patient. I sat there with those dinky little tweezers while Thanksgiving went past. So then I decided to shoot for Christmas. And then I got to thinking about the cheese. And we don't have room in that refrigerator for two pets. Because my ironing is in there. It's older than the cheese. All our kids are grown. I got baby clothes in the ironing. The inside of that refrigerator got to looking so bad, I unscrewed the bulb. And now it's very dark and lovely, except I can't see what I'm doing. A friend came over, I gotta tell you this. She wanted a little snack. I went in there in the dark and sliced off a sliver from my ironing. It cuts just like cheese, really. And it looked great on the cracker. She loved it. Dotted Swiss cheese, what the hell? But she called me from the hospital. Oh, my glory. Oh, I couldn't hear. The pumps were making more noise than she was. But I had my own problems with that turkey. See, I had already learned the true meaning of the word foul. So I had to get that thing out of the house. Here's what I did. I hung the body out the window. It was cold, and I shut the window on the neck, left the head inside, I went on with my work. And everything was going great until I get this call from the ugly woman downstairs. Oh, you wouldn't like her. She had her nose fixed, now her mouth won't work. And I think it makes her meaner. And she's on the phone, she says, Phyllis, what is this stuff coming down the side of the building? I wondered where it was going. Nobody told me to sew up the other end. She says, what is this stuff coming down the side of the building into my window and all over my new Bigelow? I was delighted. I said, looky here, you. For one thing, Bigelow should be at work. I said, for another thing, you want to know what it is? Taste it. And she did. She flipped. They took her away. I wish they hadn't taken her through the lobby. Screaming for cranberries. She said she wanted to marry a pilgrim. And I'm right back with the food and drug idiots. But you know what I'm going to do to get them off my back about the cookbook? I'm going to rewrite it into a movie. And I've got one scene already that I'm really kind of proud of. It's the heroine in this scene is spiraling down the staircase, which is straight. The kid is loaded. She's wearing this fabulous two-piece outfit, spats. Ha, ha, ha. they're open. I love my work, you know that. Of course, this isn't it. But there's one thing about it that I am never, never going to get used to if it continues as it is, and that's the travel. You see, I have a special problem. My husband routes me, buys my tickets, and he is probably the tightest man in America with money. Just not going to believe it. I can tell you in one way, he has never picked up a check in his life. People think he has an impediment in his reach. And I can give you another example of how tight he is with money. A couple of months ago, he sent away for 1,500 pounds of steel wool. He's gonna knit a Volkswagen. But the one thing that I'm very, very insecure about is flying on the kind of flights that I'm on. Oh, gee, I love the champagne flight. Adore it. I like to be higher than the plane. And you are not gonna believe the flights he digs up. Well, the one that I hate the worst is the thrift flight because there are none of the costly extras like landing gear. And boy, these flights I'm on, these paste jobs, they're not allowed to land at an airport. That's how bad these flights are. Well, it would ruin morale. They don't really land. They just lose altitude. And I'm not nutty about old planes. You know, they paint these old planes over and over and over. I'm against it. Paint is heavy. And they never quite paint over spirit of something or other. And when I'm on a plane in a wicker seat, I'm nervous. And the signs were different down in front. It said, don't spit on the floor, it leaks. And you can't get insurance. I always try. I went up to the window, and the lady said, well, now, which plane are you on? I said, the one they just carried out. That did it. But she was very gracious. We prayed together. And then she gave me a complimentary hymnal. And boy, when I'm that scared, I don't sing. I throw up. And I have one big beat. And this goes for every flight, including the best. The jets, the first class, the champagne. Have you ever been on a flight when just before takeoff time, there weren't three idiots out on the wing tightening things? Seem a little late. And why do they all look like they flunked sandbox? I even worry for they aren't getting the liquor in the right hole. I watched them gas this thing. And there were no two propellers the same size. They'd gotten a great buy on props. And they gassed one engine and threaded the other. You know, I'm not ready for these kind of flights because I'd love to live to be a little old lady. And you know that these flights have got to be piloted by reject pilots. Guys that couldn't make it with the bus company. I can see the meeting now. They say, well, Charlie's such a sweetheart. Oh, who cares about sweetheart-hood? And you know, they say, well, he can't handle traffic. Well, we'll send him upstairs. Oh, and when this guy got on, oh, he was having a little dizzy spell. And you're not ready for his breath. I was cleaning my dress. You could see the spots disappearing. I watched him turn a leopard coat back to rabbit. Honest to goodness, his breath smelled like the lamps of China. And he was in the same condition as the Great Wall, stone. is dressed very unorthodox, may I tell you that? Wearing a beanie. With the propeller on the inside. And we could have used it on the outside. And you know your captain should have four stripes, right? The man in our men's room has six. I'd sooner fly with him. In the men's room. This guy gets on there with one lousy stripe. No sleeve, just the stripe. Well, I gotta talk to this idiot and find out if he's as bad off as he looks. So that it's gonna have to be a very simple question or the answer will scare me to death. So I said, sweetie, what time is it? He said, the big hand is on six. Tomorrow. The weather is smooth. What are you going to do? He's up there in the rocker. And it was the roughest fight I was ever on in my life. The woman behind me was salting my hair. I couldn't figure it out. I thought maybe she'd found a cute new way to meet people. I thought that right up until the minute she stuck a fork in me. And then didn't she have the nerve to complain about the spaghetti with the black roots? About that time, the captain's voice came over the loudspeaker. This is a Dixie cup and a string. He says, we are cruising at an altitude of 50 feet. Well, not all of them. To tell you the truth, we were cutting the trucks. A headwind hung him up on one spot. In a town, he had the nickel a meter. He was over that spot so long it was reached. By now, I am up to page 43 in the hymnal. Singing everything. I nearly choked on Nearer My God to Thee. I sang the index twice. I was looking for an up tune. Took the next 100 years, I could never describe the stewardess. And I'll tell you why. We don't have any wrinkled words. Ah, you talk about old. I loved her. She was older than the plane. I figured she had to be one of the Wright sisters. But you know why they couldn't fire her? She had her foot caught in the floor. They are using this for the landing gear. Which could explain some of the wrinkles. That may have aged her. I never saw such wrinkles in my life. She looked like she'd been carried out of Shangri-La. At least twice. By Dorian Gray. And every time she smiled, a piece of makeup fell off. But she was very cool about it. She'd kick it under the seat. Oh, with her free foot, you know, this one. You know where women get those little teeny crow's feet? This broad had mastodon tracks. But I don't want to knock her. Because she was so busy. You know that she had to mend all that Kleenex. She she had to dry every Dixie cup? And some idiot had drunk out of the loudspeaker. And he had choked on the string. And now the captain is talking into his stomach. And the stewardess was trying to revive him with mouth breathing. Well, it looked terrible. It's one thing on a beach, it's another thing on a plane. And that old broad wouldn't stop. Oh, yeah, she's getting her kicks. So they were married by a druggist. But I'm going to level with you one more time. I don't like any stewardesses, and I never have, and I doubt if I ever will be able to. And I'll tell you why. Nobody's that happy. They're all just fresh out of idiot school. And they're so itsy-bitsy happy-wappy. And they know the wings are loose. And another thing I don't like about them, and this never fails, they always come directly over to me. Just because I look like I might. And it's always that same icky sweetie pie attitude. I thought I was gonna die of syrup poisoning. She says, now we aren't gonna be sick, are we? I said, watch. Thank you so much. You know, I shouldn't even be out tonight, actually. I have this small chest condition. It's chronic. My father had it. We figured one of the girls would come up with it. And that's hardly the term. Embarrassing. You know, I work a lot of places where they have a dance floor, and one night a gentleman asked me to dance and then danced three sets with me backwards. All the time complimenting me on my figure. I said, you idiot, those are my shoulder blades. I thought your bangs were a little bit long. But he said, your breath is so bad, I was glad it was coming out the back. And then I made a dreadful mistake about 4 years ago. I went to Hollywood to become a big star overnight, because I happen to know that's the way it's done. Well, those little starlets, come on. They get ahead so fast, you don't think it's talent, do you? Oh, let me give you an example. I think I can prove it. I went to a starlet's wedding, and here's this dumb little broad. She has exactly two words to remember, and she's been rehearsing for weeks. And she muffed her lines. She said, I did. I wish I had never had the screen test, which I wangled. It was a mess. It was a good picture, though. A Western called Separate Stables. And I had a great line. Everything is happening, and I'm supposed to say they went that way. They went nowhere. And after my test, that director walked right over to me and he said, Miss Diller, I have seen bigger lumps in oatmeal. I get so bitter, I feel like putting them both together and making one good one. Because you know it wouldn't work. Everybody would call me Miss Unicorn. But you know, I couldn't begin to tell you how grateful I am to the Goodyear people. They're doing some marvelous work now. They have brought out these fabulous new tubeless ones. Oh, they're remarkable. You can spring a leak and make it clear home before your flat. I'm sick of running on the rims. And you have never known embarrassment until you have pulled into a standard station and said, fill her up. Delighted that you came to the Hungry Eye tonight, especially it's a holiday. And, but Labor Day has something to do with labor. You know, like unions and people who work and plow and slave and do all that work. And I thought it had something to do with women and babies. Oh, I thought it was my day, you know. I was out in the street screaming and carrying on. Instead, we come into this filthy basement. And risk our lives. The reason I stay on here so long is I dread going back to that dressing room. If you think this is bad, that is worse. It leaks. I have no idea what is upstairs. But whatever is up there, somebody pulled the plug out. I love you all. See you again soon. Good night.